Good evening, Koinonia. Hey, happy Easter to you, huh? Hey, I was reading in Luke chapter 24, and it said that on the first day of the week, the women came to anoint the body of Jesus. When they got to the tomb, man, the stone was rolled away, and the thing was empty, and they began to panic, and it says that two heavenly beings appeared to them. Said, "Why do you search the living amongst the dead? He's risen." Hey, you want to know something? Those words, "He is risen," transcends time. I mean, they were said 2,000 years ago, and they are still as important today as they were 2,000 years ago. He is risen. Yeah, can you say that with me, church? He is risen. Hallelujah, Lord God. We welcome you here this day, the risen Lord Jesus. We want to worship you and glorify you and give you all praise. So we ask now, Lord God, you would inhabit the praise of your people. And it's in your name, it's your glory. Amen.
Belongs to you. Let every kingdom bow, let every ocean roar, let every heart adore you now. Praise belongs to you. What can I do but sing? The greatest joy I found is to lay a crown before my
celebration. So why don't we turn around and greet one another. If there's someone that you do not know, go ahead and introduce yourself and let us enter into celebrating the resurrection of our Lord. Amen.
Through you the blind will see. Through you the
you have been set free from something by the power of the Lord. Amen? Sing this together.
No more shackles, no more chains, no more bondage. I am free. No more shackles, no more chains, no more bondage. I am free. No more shackles, no more chains, no more bondage. I am free. No more shackles, no more chains, no more bondage. I am free. No more shackles, no more chains.
I am free. I am free. Jesus, for setting us free. Thank you, Jesus, for dying for me. Thank you, my God. Thank you, my God. Father, I thank you that we can celebrate a living, resurrected Christ and Savior tonight. Lord, I thank you that we can stand here tonight and say, we know that you are alive. We know that you are alive. We know that you are alive, our King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And Father, because you gave your Son to give his life for us, we can come to you and we can offer our lives up to you. God, take our lives, take our hands. Father, help us to want to serve you willingly and always with everything that we are. Bless you, Jesus.
Because I know that you're alive. You came to fix my broken life. And I see you
We know you are alive, our God. We honor you, our King. So thank you for the cross, Lord. Thank you for the price you paid, bearing all my sin and shame. In love you came and gave amazing grace. Thank you for this love.
Make a declaration this evening. Worthy is the Lamb. Worthy are you, O God. Worthy are you, King of kings and Lord of lords. We praise you tonight, God. We worship you, Master. Jesus, we love you tonight. So wonderful to be in your house this evening, God. So wonderful to worship you, to remember that you're not in the grave today, but that you are resurrected, seated at the right hand of the Father, ruling today, seated on a throne of grace, extending your arms to us even this evening, God. We thank you so much for that. We worship you tonight. Lord, thank you. Thank you for what you've done. Thank you for defeating sin and death. Thank you for being the victor over every situation, every challenge, everything that we face in our lives. We remember what you have done, O God. We stand in awe tonight, and we praise you in Jesus' name. And the church said, amen. As Roger said when we opened the service, he is risen.
Well, we didn't practice that apparently enough. He is risen. You say he is risen indeed. He is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Ah, there it is. Welcome this evening. You may take your seats. So wonderful to have you tonight. I'm Pastor Andrew, and this is Pastor Jeff. Pastor Jeff, you want to say hi?
Good evening.
And we're just going to take a moment and let you know about some of the things that are coming up. And so if you would, just pull out your bulletin that you came in the door. If you didn't get one of these, we would love to encourage you to get one. The ushers have them at the back of the auditorium because inside of there is this red wristband thing, and so you will need that at some point during the service. Hint, hint. So if you didn't get one, you want to grab one right now. We want to just take a moment and welcome any guests. If you're here for the first time this weekend, maybe you're with us because it's Easter weekend, you're here with your family, you're visiting from out of town, or you got invited and you're here tonight, we just want to say welcome to you. We love it that you're here with us, and we've got a gift that we want to give to you and some other things. I think Jeff's got some info about those other things.
Yeah, if you're maybe this is your first time with us this evening, and for some reason maybe you came out to join us for Easter, and we're excited that you're here, and we love to celebrate Easter here at Koinonia. And you'll notice that there's a connection card in your bulletin, and you can use that for a few different things. But if you're visiting or a guest with us this evening, we'd just like you to take a moment, fill that out. We have a few questions on there. We ask you to tell us a little bit about yourself. And then the second question that you'll notice is, why did you get out of bed and come to church? Now, you might think that's more oriented towards the Sunday morning crowd, but hey, you know, if you guys were just taking an awesome nap and decided to get up and come this evening, that could be fitting. But one of the answers there is, I'm a creaster. Anybody know what a creaster is? A few of you know what a creaster is. A creaster is someone who simply goes to church on Christmas and Easter. You know, Christmas, Easter together, creaster.
It's very clever. I mean, it takes a while for people to grab it. I understand.
Christmas, Easter, put together, creaster. So maybe you are a creaster, and if that is you, that's great. Just let us know. We would love to hear that. But if you could, just take a couple minutes and fill that out. Maybe we can get you to come a different...
we have a special mailing list for you just, you know, twice a year. That's the only time we bother you.
And so just take a minute to fill that out. But we do have a gift that we would like to give you as well out in the lobby. There's a guest services counter, and if you would just stop by there, we got some goodies in here. I think a little book, a water bottle, some chocolates. I'm going to take this one home with me, but there's some other ones out there for you guys. So stop by guest services. We'd love to connect with you.
It's not for you Koinonia people that are coming every weekend, for those people that are new tonight, okay?
And the creasters.
We also want to let you know about a couple of things that are coming up. Discovery 1 is a class that is recommended for everyone that's a part of Koinonia, or maybe you're beginning to come and you want to know who we are, what we believe, where we're headed. The Discovery series is all about that. And Discovery 1 in particular is taught by our lead pastor, Tim Howard. And he basically explains, you know, who it is that we are here at Koinonia. Why are we so strange? Why do we do the things we do? And that is going to be happening next Sunday, April the 11th. You don't have to sign up for that necessarily. You can just show up. It's after the second service at 12:45. We serve you lunch, and there's childcare for the kids. So maybe you're here tonight for the first time, and you say, well, maybe we need to check out really what they're all about. It's a great way to do that. Just come back next week after that second service at 12:45, and you can jump right into Discovery 1.
Many of you know about the King's Pantry. The King's Pantry is a ministry here at Koinonia that we got some King's Pantry,
Pantry fans.
Servants and fans down here. But the King's Pantry just really is there to meet the needs of people in our community with food. We also offer clothing as well. And so it's a little brown house out here on the corner of our property. And I know that over the last several weeks, we've been talking about doing a food drive for the pantry. And so if you did bring food this evening, you can simply drop it at guest services tonight. Before you leave, we'll also be collecting food tomorrow in both services as well.
You note in your bulletin there's this large insert that says Group Connect. And so if you just pull it out just for a second, Group Connect is our groups of classes, our Bible studies, our classes and groups that happen three times per year. And so we're about to start a new session of that in 2 weeks, the week of April 18th. All of our classes start basically that week. And so you'll note here there are classes almost every night of the week. If you're interested in studying the Bible, if you're interested in dealing with your anger, learning how to overcome your anger, if you're interested in many different areas, there is probably a group for you that you can find there. So they're separated by heading. Some of them are on Tuesday nights and Wednesday nights and other nights of the week. So you just check that out, some for men, some for women. And all these begin in just a couple, in just 2 weeks, the week of April 18th. It's a great way to get plugged into Koinonia, a great way to grow in your faith, and many times a great way to meet other people who are part of the church. Sometimes we come in and go out the doors, but we don't have an opportunity or don't take the opportunity to sort of build some relationships. And this is one of those maybe opportunities where you can get into a class and make some faces familiar to you and learn some names and begin to build some community.
Yeah, we're all about encouraging people to take next steps. And so maybe you've been coming on Sunday mornings for a while, and maybe it's time for you to take a next step and to step out into something new, and one of these classes might fit for you or a small group. But on the connection card, that green card in your bulletin, it tears off. And on the back there, it has a section called Next Steps. And you can simply sign up for any of those Group Connect classes or opportunities on that. If there is a payment, we just ask that you would include that on there. There's envelopes and the seat backs in front of you. There's also, you can sign up for the Discovery class on there, or baptism as well, or child dedications. And so just really do encourage people to take next steps in growing in their walk towards Jesus Christ. And Easter's a great opportunity for us to take some of those next steps.
Yeah, and if you don't have time to fill out that connection card, by the time the offering comes by, there's no worries. On your way out the door, you can drop it off at guest services, and we'll take care of that for you. We want to let you know that starting next week, we're going to launch a new teaching series called Battling Giants. So over the next 6 to 8 weeks, we're going to be focusing on some of the giants that we all face in our life. Giants of finances, giants of temptation, giants of failure and shame, and a number of others. And so next week that launches, and some really important giants that we'll learn principles from God's word on how we can be victorious in our daily life. And so just a heads up on what's beginning next Sunday.
Ushers, if you guys would go ahead and come forward, we'll go ahead and receive tithes and offerings. And as we do that, let's just go ahead and pray over the offering as well. Jesus, we just come before you this evening, and we just say thank you. As we've been celebrating and singing and worshiping you, we just come before you and say thank you for your love and your grace. We thank you for your willingness to go to the cross for our benefit, to die on a cross so that we would have salvation from sin and salvation from death. And we just say thank you tonight, and just thank you that you are our provider, that you are our provision. And we just pray that you would take these tithes and offerings and that you would further them to extend your kingdom, both here in Hanford, but also throughout the world. We pray a blessing over them, pray a blessing over those who give. And again, extend your kingdom, Lord Jesus, through our giving. And again, we just say thank you for your love, your grace, and mercy. And we celebrate you tonight, Jesus. Amen.
I cling to the cross and everything it means. I know it's the only hope there is for saving me. For without your great mercy, I would be forever lost. With a thankful heart, I come, cling to the cross. Cling to the cross, everything it means. I know it's the only hope there is for saving me. For without your great mercy, I would be forever lost. And with a thankful heart, I come. Cling to the cross.
Standing at the empty tomb, promises I have in you are mine.
I was made alive in you,
Everything you said was true. You suffered, died, and rose to bring us love. Oh, to bring us life.
I cling to the cross and everything it means. I know it's the only hope there is for saving me. For without your great mercy, I would be forever lost. With a thankful heart, I come.
Jesus, I come.
With a thankful heart, I come.
Oh, with a thankful heart, I come.
Saving grace, who took Calvary and stand in our place and say, no turning back, no turning back.
Cling to the cross
and everything it means, Lord.
I cling to the cross.
And there's no other hope for me, God.
Up in the sky, he's a person up in heaven.
Our Savior.
He loves us.
Lamb of God.
God. Love.
Jesus is our Savior. He is the person who made all of us.
Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior.
Jesus is God's Son, the Lord.
Jesus is the person who died on the cross.
Like the Father, he is the ruler of everything.
Bad stuff? I did it.
When you do something wrong?
Bad stuff.
Sins are bad.
It's bad, and whoever sins, they go up in hell.
A lie? Well, sin is like when you lie and like when stuff says like do not touch, you touch it and stuff.
Like grabbing places.
The opposite of what God wants you to do.
Doing something bad.
If you're being bad.
Sin means like you kill somebody.
I don't even know that trick.
When somebody does bad, like slap somebody, says bad words like this, you poop.
Everybody gets to hunt for Easter eggs.
And the eggs are colors all over.
when Jesus died and then when he rose.
To spend time with friends and family.
He died on the cross for us.
You find eggs and you eat eggs.
He dies on the cross for our sins.
Eggs. He gets hurt and gets a boomerang right here.
Bunnies.
A celebration that we have because Jesus rose from the dead.
Jesus died on a cross to take our sins away.
He died, and 3 days later, he rose again.
Where you get to go all wild.
Freedom is like good stuff, like I'm free, I'm happy now.
Free to do anything.
If you don't have directions, you can just do whatever you want.
It's giving something now for free. I don't know.
I don't know. Kind of being by yourself, kind of like.
You can do anything you want.
It's when you get away.
Freedom is like because Jesus died on the cross.
God releases you from all your sins.
I would do, I would make my own food, play, and buy my own toys.
Pray.
Hit someone.
Go a wild land, swim in the pool when it was freezing cold.
I would work on a dairy with my dad.
Go to Monterey with my mom.
I'd want to go to heaven and come back and just whenever so I could get like wisdom from God. Help other people get total freedom.
Go to my grandma's house.
Play video games all day.
See my cousins.
Play baseball.
Go play.
I would like play with my Batman toys and do other stuff.
Arch cartoonist. I'll eat strawberries and visit my grandma.
Face my fears.
I would fly.
I can relate. I feel like a kid. I don't want to grow up. I feel sometimes like I have more questions than I do have answers. We're still looking for some answers, aren't we? Well, good evening, everyone. Happy Easter. My name is Tim Howard, and it's my privilege to be the lead pastor here at Koinonia Christian Fellowship. And it's awesome to celebrate Jesus with all of you and to focus specifically on the cross and the resurrection. You really can't just focus on the resurrection without the cross, and you can't just focus on the cross without the resurrection. No matter how thin you slice anything, it always has two sides, and they kind of go together. And we get to focus this weekend and tonight with you folks. And tomorrow in two services, a couple thousand people will probably join us. And we get to focus on specifically what Jesus provided for you and me by dying on a cross and by being raised by the power of God. The cross is God's greatest statement of love for you and me. And the resurrection is his greatest statement of power. That means he can carry out all of his promises to us. If I were to sum up the Easter message in one word, and that's probably impossible to do, and maybe you'd choose a different term, and that's okay, you'd be as right as I would be. But you've heard it several times already tonight. It'd be the word freedom. What does Easter say to us? It means freedom. God sent his son. He lived among us to bring us freedom. And if you're like me, you know how easy it is to get stuck in life. And whenever I've gotten stuck, whenever I've broken down in a car, I've always needed someone else to help me. I've always needed to make a call. Donna, would you come and pick me up? I've had to take my car to the mechanic. Someone has needed to get me out of the pickle that I found myself in. It's easy to get stuck in life. You may have heard that little phrase, you get stuck between a rock and a hard place. Some of you may be here tonight and you're stuck between a rock and a hard place. You can get stuck in abusive relationships. You can get stuck in habits, addictions that really do siphon your life away.
I'm 59 years old, and if some of you are as old as I am, you probably remember a song that was written in 1972 called Stuck in the Middle with You. And it's about a long-term relationship, not marriage necessarily, but it could be. But it was about a relationship that was long-term, and it lost its spark, if you will. And sometimes when you're in a long-term relationship and it loses that zing, you can feel like you're stuck. And what you want is to get free. You want to experience something. The Bible talks about you and me getting entangled in things. It doesn't use the word stuck, but it does use the word entangled. We get caught. We get trapped. Actually, we get bound. Bound by things. Similar to the picture, if you noticed on your bulletin, a picture of handcuffs. It's as if at times life, we go in certain places and we get bound. And just like a policeman would put handcuffs on you and take you away, we find that we can still live and still move and still do certain things, but we're bound and we're not free. And God has come to set us free. Tonight I want to talk with you about three dimensions of freedom that God offers us that are made available to anyone who believes in Him, anyone who puts their faith in Him, their confidence in Him. These three dimensions of faith, these three dimensions of freedom are available. And to help illustrate that, in your bulletin there should be three wristbands. And if you would take those out, I know that we got a bulletin tonight and it didn't have three wristbands in that bulletin, but you should have three wristbands. And I'm just going to invite you to, there's no one going to hold a gun to your head and check to see if you're doing this or not, but I want to invite you to participate by separating all three of those right now. Just kind of rip those apart, and each of those wristbands are going to kind of speak of the one dimension of bondage that God wants to set us free from. So if you've got them ripped, and it sounds like you're still ripping them, but after you finish, they kind of look like kind of a hospital wristband. And on one end, you can peel it off. And then I'm going to ask you just to take one at this time, and would you put it around your left wrist, So you're going to take the little piece of paper off there, put it around your right wrist, right arm. Did I say left? Left, I'm sorry. Do left. See, I'm trying to do it and talk at the same time. And I have a hard time walking and breathing at the same time. So, yes, your left arm. Okay. Have you all got it on? Okay, this represents yesterday's pain. God came to dwell among us. He became human. He revealed himself through Jesus Christ. Jesus, in fact, was God. And so Jesus was God revealed in the flesh. He died on a cross. He rose again by the power of his Father. And he did that, first of all, this first dimension, to free you and me from yesterday's pain.
Morning.
Hey, did you look at the mail from yesterday?
Did not even glance. Why?
You got a letter from Random House Publishing.
Are you serious?
Can I read it?
Yeah, go ahead.
Dear Mr. Baker, thank you for submitting your manuscript. Unfortunately, at this time, we are not... I'm sorry.
Don't be.
Look, you'll try again.
Try again? Try again? I've tried, Karen. I've been trying for 4 years. 50 manuscripts I've sent out, over 100 letters of inquiry, and for what? I can't even get a single letter of interest. Dad was right.
About what?
that the closest I would ever get to selling a book would be by working in a bookstore.
You can't think like that.
How can't I? Here's the evidence, Karen. I'm a failure. I'm never going to make enough money for us to get a house. I'm never going to get out of my deadbeat job. I'm never going to be anything different than I was 4 years ago when everyone told me I was a fool to think I could make it in this business. I'm sorry. I've let you down.
Look, we're getting by just fine. You're working as hard as you can and investing all your spare time into writing. I know you can do it, Rick. You know I wouldn't just say that.
It was just a stupid dream. I should have at least taken that job your brother offered me. At least then we'd have enough money to have a savings at this point. 4 years, Karen. What a pathetic waste. We could have been more than this, Karen. I should have been more.
Disappointments. Wow, they can paralyze you, can't they? Have you anybody experienced past disappointments? Things haven't worked out. I've tried, turned down. I try and try again and get turned down again and again. I make those sales. I'm in sales. I make those calls. I've had to knock on doors and cold call people and it's just not working. All of a sudden, you can be paralyzed. You can get stuck, a little timid, a little afraid of, a little paranoid of making another call. So you begin to draw back. Disappointments really hurt. Disappointment's not the only thing that gets us stuck. Hurts get us stuck. I know people who don't go to church anymore. They've been hurt by someone in the past. And because they got hurt by that person, they went to church. They said they loved God, but they were just a hypocrite. And they got hurt, and so therefore they've just turned on God. Listen, if you ever go to listen to a seventh grade class play Beethoven and do a recital with Beethoven music, don't turn off Beethoven just because of the seventh grade class. You know, they're not the greatest players in the world. Sometimes we can turn on God because of hurts that have happened to us. Some of the most unhappy people that I've ever met, generally speaking, and I wouldn't say this is true all of the time, but more often than not, I've found that unhappy people today are connected to some of the past hurts that they've never dealt with. We've all got a history. We've all got dark areas inside. We've all been hurt. We carry along a lot of baggage. So much baggage sometimes this week, it just takes a lot of effort just to move ahead into the future. And you know, God sent his son to deliver us and to help us to unpack that baggage. He sent his son to free us from that pain that we experienced yesterday, that hurt that came back yesterday. We've all done things that we're ashamed of. I know I sure have. And if it weren't for God's grace and his death and his resurrection that freed me from guilt and shame and condemnation, I'd still be back in the past carrying around this. God doesn't want you and me to carry around guilt. He doesn't want us to carry around all of these hurts from the past. That's why he sent his son Jesus to die on the cross. He died for all of your stupid decisions, all of my stupid choices, my dumb things that I've done, the sin, the things that I've done wrong. I've violated God's law. I've done lawlessness, so to speak. I've done what he hasn't wanted me to do. Something's wrong with me inside. But he wants to heal that. He says, I want to free you from that so that you can move on. But there's also another dimension of freedom. Before I give that to you, let me just take in your bulletins, and you may not be able to see because of the lighting, but let me read it to you. This is what God says about yesterday's pain. The Lord says, forget about what's happened before. Do not think about the past. Instead, look at the new thing I'm going to do. All of us have sinned, Romans chapter 3 says. Yet God declares us not guilty if we trust in Jesus Christ, who in his mercy freely takes away our sins, frees us from all those things in the past. I love this from Job. Listen to this from the NIV. If you devote your heart to him and stretch out your hands to him, if you put away the sin that is in your hand and allow no evil to dwell in your house, they use the word tent, but it's in your home, then free of fault, you will lift up your face, you will stand firm without fear, you will surely forget your trouble, recalling it only as waters gone by. Life will be brighter than noonday, and darkness will become like the morning. That's what happens to the person who has a horrid past, but now finds God. He frees them and gives them a bright future. There's also another dimension. If you'd take that second strand, a wristband for me, and put it on your right hand this time, your right hand. I cannot find mine, so I don't know what happened to it. If you'll put it on your right hand. This band represents not yesterday's pain, but he also came to set us free from tomorrow's uncertainty. That's on your right hand now, so you should have two of them that kind of look like that. God came to earth, lived among us, revealed himself through Jesus Christ. Jesus died on the cross. He rose again to set us free. It's a powerful, powerful statement in John 8. He says, if you know the truth will set you free. And verse 36 says, and when he, the Son, sets you free, you will be free indeed. He came to set us free in this second dimension from tomorrow's uncertainties.
Michelle, sorry to keep you waiting so long. We're a little bit understaffed and the appointments have been booked up back to back, so my apologies.
That's okay. The lady on the phone said you just needed me to come in to go over the results from last week.
That's right, Michelle. I wanted you to come in and talk to you face to face. I don't know how to tell you this other than to just come out and say it. We got your initial test results back and they came back positive. Your CT scans indicate that you have a series of tumorous growths on your pancreas and your liver. Michelle, you have cancer.
Cancer? Is it curable?
It's too early to tell, but it's imperative that you see a surgeon as quickly as possible.
Am I gonna die?
Again, it's too early to tell, but the initial prognosis doesn't look good. However, I want you to know that there are a series of breakthrough medications and treatment programs that have been developed in the last few years. It's gonna buy us some time, or could do even more than that. I've taken the liberty of scheduling an appointment with one of the surgeons on the next floor. He's waiting for you now. I need you to go up as soon as you're ready.
Okay, can I just have a moment?
Of course. Michelle, I am sorry.
For many in our society, that's a very, very true thing that really happens time and again. You talk about uncertainty. How long do I have? None of us really know how long we have. That's why it's so important to make decisions today that are beneficial for you and right before God. Procrastination is one of the worst, I'd even call it sin, because when you put off till tomorrow, you don't know if you have tomorrow. Uncertainty. We are surrounded, aren't we, folks, with uncertainty in our society? What are our kids going to be learning? You know, will they be prepared for the job market in 20 years from now? I mean, forget about their job market. What about our job market? You know, who's going to get the next pink slip? Who's going to be out of a job? 18% in the Fresno area, and it's high around this area. The economy. I mean, there's uncertainty in the economy. You know, with some of the decisions that are being made, and those who have higher authorities. I mean, there's questions in my mind about the uncertainty of the future. There's a lot of worry and a lot of fear, a lot of anxiety. And those things in themselves can get you stuck. They can freeze you up, can't they? You can not know where you're going, and the unknown is a scary thing. When I was growing up as a kid back east, I was afraid of the dark. I don't know if you have a specific fear that you have. I don't have to sleep with the light on any longer now because I've got my wife next to me, and if something goes wrong, I just kick her out of the bed and tell her to go take care of it. But so I don't have to fear any longer. But when I was a kid, you know, I've read that it says when you're born you have two fears, and I don't know if this is true or not, but it says when you're born you're afraid of loud noises and afraid of falling. But it's obvious that in becoming adults, we develop hundreds of fears plus. And mine was afraid of the dark. But the greatest fear that I can think of that I personally encountered is the fear of the unknown, uncertainty. In 2002, when we left our former pastorate position, I didn't have a job, didn't know where we were going, just knew that God had told us to do that. I wouldn't recommend that to anyone. It's not really a wise step unless you really know it's God, and it was God for us. But there was a whole lot of uncertainty. How are we going to pay our bills? You know, how are we going to take care of our medical insurance? All of those things, the uncertainties of life. And sometimes the uncertainties can keep you locked into a place too. And it kept me locked into a place for a couple of years. I should have probably left a couple of years prior to when I did, but that fear of the unknown, the uncertainty, really grabbed my heart. But God says something to us about those fears. When he talks about the future, listen to what he says. And this is in Jeremiah 29 in your bulletin back page. It says, I know what I'm planning for you, says the Lord. I have good plans for you, not plans to hurt you. I will give you hope and a good future. The mountains and hills may crumble, but my love for you will never end, says the Lord, who loves you. We have a God who's got it all covered. He's got us covered. He's got your past covered. He knows what's happening in your present, and he's got your future covered. I was brought up in a home and there with some my sisters, and all of us, I can't really speak for them, but I can say to you as a small child, I never worried about would I have a bed to sleep in. Never worried about, will I have a coat that keeps me warm in the winter? Will I have food on the table? I never worried about that because my dad provided for that. We didn't always have a lot to eat. We come from very humble means. Didn't always have the updated clothes. Sometimes it was used clothes that we had to purchase and wear. But my dad took care of that. You see, God sent his son to die on a cross for you and me so that we wouldn't have to worry about those things. He says, you got enough worries about today. Don't worry about tomorrow. There's a lot of uncertainties, a lot of things that could happen or might happen, but you can't focus on that. You must understand that I'm your dad. There's a third dimension. God sent his son to die and to be raised again so that he could free us from yesterday's pain, our past, from tomorrow's uncertainty. But he also wants to deliver you and me from the pressures of today. I'm going to ask you to take your third wristband, and Donna, my lovely wife, if you'd come up and help me, put this on, please. I need to have you help me, and you'll need a friend to help you do this as well, unless you're really, really talented. But I'm going to ask you to kind of in same fashion as that handcuff is on your bulletins, that picture, I'm going to ask you to handcuff yourself together with this third dimension, kind of like that. So you should kind of look like this now. We can get bound up in our past. We can get really freaked out about the future and even accept a pessimistic view. But also we can get hung up in the present pressures of the world. God sent His Son. He came in human form, lived among us, revealed Himself through Jesus. He died on a cross. He was rose again so that we could be free from today's pressures.
Watching that.
What are you doing? I'm trying to clean up around here, and you've thrown your stuff everywhere. Ugh. And you're late. You're barely going to have time to take a shower before our daughter's recital tonight.
Sweetie, this was almost a 12-hour workday. I'm tired. Isn't someone going to be videotaping it?
You didn't go to her last recital because you said you had a long workday and you were going to bed early. And when we came home, you were watching TV.
Look, sweetie, let's be honest. This is the fourth recital she's had already this year. I mean, between Becky's recitals, practices, deadlines at work, Michael's baseball games, his practices. When are we supposed to have some downtime?
When you start saying no to your boss and come home more nights before the kids are asleep.
You know what? You would think it's that simple, wouldn't you? You know what? I got news for you. With the boss that I got, with the deadlines he gives me, with the resources he gives me, it's nothing like the perfect little world you got going on here.
Excuse me? I take care of the kids, this house, and I work.
Yeah, part-time, honey. There's a big difference. And I'm sorry, are you sure about the house part? Because I'm looking around, and you got me fooled.
Well, gee, honey, with what you bring home every month, I have to work just so we can keep this house. Where's Becky's dress?
How should I know?
You were supposed to pick it up.
Oh, shoot. I forgot.
You forgot? You always do this.
I can run to the cleaners real quick and get it. It's not a big deal.
No, you can't, because they're going to be closed in 10 minutes.
Look, sweetie, I'm sorry. There's been a lot on my mind at work. It slipped my mind.
It always slips your mind. You're either too busy, you're too tired, or you forget.
Pressure. Pressure. Can anybody relate? Have you ever said, I'm burned out? I'm stressed out. I'm at my rope's end. I'm on my last leg. I'm about to come unglued. I mean, how many ways are there to say it? I'm going to throw in the towel. If you've ever said phrases like that, it means that you have come into contact with pressure. And pressure is used to shape us into a certain type of person. Romans 8 says, don't be conformed by the pressures of the world. By the world. The world has pressure. It tries to shape you. If you're not careful, when you go through all the pressures, it can separate relationships. It can break up marriages. It can cause you to be frustrated and angry, and you begin to become a cynical person. You can become an apathetic person. You can become a lazy person. The pressures have a way of shaping you. Listen to what God says. It's just this is one of my favorite verses to read to you. It talks about today's pressures, and it says in Isaiah 40, God never grows faint or weary. He gives power to those who are tired and worn out. I can do everything with the help of Christ who gives me strength I need. And then Jesus himself says, are you tired? Are you worn out? Are you burned out on religion? Come to me for real rest, and you'll recover your life, and you'll learn to live freely and lightly. Paul, the apostle, in Romans chapter 7, he didn't have handcuffs on him, but somehow he recognized the bondage and the things in life that can keep us from becoming what God has created us to become. And in verse 24 of that chapter, he says, "O wretched man that I am, who can set me free?" And he calls it from this death, from things that suck the joy right out of my life, that take away all my vibrancy and make me less than God created me to be. Who, he says, can deliver me? In the very next verse, it's almost like a revelation happens. And he says, thanks be to God through Jesus Christ. See, Jesus is the one who came, died, rose again to set us free. Free from past pain, yesterday's pain, tomorrow's uncertainty, the fear of what's coming up, who knows what tomorrow brings, and today's pressures. But how does he do that? How does God free us? How does Jesus free us? I want to conclude tonight by giving you three ways that God frees us. And they're very simple. I've listed them in the bulletin. There's not even you don't even need to fill them in, just as a reminder to you. But the first one is, you need to put your faith in God. The second one is, you need to focus on God. And three, you need to walk with God. Let me talk with you just briefly about those three things. Because I believe that there are people going to be gathering tonight and tomorrow who will fall into one of these categories. There are going to be people, and maybe you're here tonight, you've never put your faith in God. That's where it begins. When a person puts their faith in Jesus Christ, that opens the door for a relationship. That's the way every relationship grows. It's when I met my wife and she met me, I wouldn't have given me the time of day, but she did. Somehow she had a little bit of confidence in me and believed in me, so she set up another appointment. We met a second time, then we met a third time, and we started to grow, and then we got married. It started by her putting some confidence and trust in me. Faith in God. But what is faith? Faith has to do with believing what you don't see. Believing what you don't see. I have something in my hand. Anybody tell me what I have in my hand? I have something in my hand. I'd like to meet, I think we have enough time. I'd like to meet, I didn't know if I was going to do this or not, but I am. And I'd like to meet someone I've never met before. And I'd like to have you stand. You may be a visitor tonight. You may be maybe you've come to the church for some time, and I've just never had the privilege of meeting you. I'd like to illustrate what faith is. It may not be totally the only answer, but I'd like to give it a shot. And I promise I'll ask you just a couple of questions. It will not embarrass you. A fifth grader could answer the questions, okay? But if you're an adult here tonight, so I'll make it really easy. I promise I will not embarrass you. But if you've never met me, I have something in my hand tonight. I'd like to have you stand up. Okay, would you stand up, please? Now, I'm going to ask you, you know, you don't have to tell me the year that you were born, okay, because I know it's terrible to ask. See, I'm violating what I just said, huh? But if you just want to tell me the day, or if you want to do the year, that's fine, too. What's your birth date?
8-9-59.
8-9-59, okay. Now, how do you know that that's your birth date?
Because that's what I was told.
So someone told you, and every time you sign a check or every time you fill out a document or something, every time you do something, you put that date down when they ask your birthday, and you believe that because not that you remember it, because you were just, you couldn't remember it. Someone told you that, and that belief, and that's affecting you even today. See, that's a part of what belief really is. It's putting belief in something. Now, have you ever been to Finland?
No.
Do you believe that there is a place called Finland? Okay, and you probably believe that because maybe you've heard it someplace, you've studied it, or it was on the television or something, but there is a place called Finland. But you believe there's a place there even though you have not seen it. Now, what do I have in my hand?
Air.
I have air in my hand. Okay, and now that's a good guess, but that's your opinion. Okay, that's your opinion. And everyone, you might be here tonight and you have an opinion as to what I have in my hand. But I'm going to tell you, I have $10 in my hand. Now, you don't know me. I've never met you before, but I have the reputation of being somewhat honest. I don't lie.
Okay,
I don't lie. I don't lie all the time. I try to be truthful. I'm going to ask you. I'm telling you. I have $10 in my hand. Will you believe me?
Yes.
Okay. So she said she would believe me. Now, that's what faith really is. It's not just guessing or hoping or wishing or having an opinion. It's she's believing what I said about what I have in my hand. Now, your faith is going to vanish right now. It's going to change. Okay? It's going to change. I'm going to open my hand, look in my hand. What do I have?
$10.
Okay, you have no longer, you don't have faith. What you have is knowledge now.
Yes.
Now, see, what we want is we want knowledge, but God says you have to have faith. And when you have faith, I'll open up my hand, and aren't you glad you came tonight? You got a $10 right there for you to have a cup of coffee on the way out. So, that's what faith is. It's believing, not just, you know, it's believing in something that someone has revealed to you that's true. I'm telling you, there are people here, if you look in the bulletin, there are stories, three stories in the back panel. And you can start to read those and then get on the internet and check out our webpage and for the rest of the story. But there are people who are freed from alcoholism, freed from addictions, freed from cancer. And there, story after story after story, you will hear from the lives of people telling you that Jesus lived, died, and rose again. But I have learned and discovered that you're not completely free just because you put your faith in Jesus. Now, if you die and you have faith in him, you're going to go to heaven if you die. But freedom is an ongoing process. It's continuing to develop. I may be the lead pastor here, but I've still got a lot of problems. I've still got some weird thinking. I've still got some things that I do wrong. I still need to have the freeing work of God happen in my life. And it happens as I start to put my faith in him. But the second thing I need to do is put my focus on him. And as you put your focus on him, there's a continued outgrowth of this freedom that he offers. I was watching my grandson just a while back, and as I kept my eye on him, focusing on him, I was watching him do his thing. I was at the park. His dad was at work. Donna was gone, so I took him to the park this day. And I looked down, and I was trying to read while I was watching him, and I looked up, and I couldn't see him. I don't know if you've ever been taking care of your child in a public place and you look up and you can't see him. And what happened is there was this sensation from the pit of my gut all the way up to my throat. And I, Drew! Drew! And I start hollering and he wouldn't come. And so I started to really scurry around and all of a sudden I saw him and I settled back down again. See, when you focus on something, there's something intentional that you do. You look into His Word, the Bible. You look into books. You look into any way that you can. How can I serve? I've been told that if I serve and I get involved, that Christianity is not just about getting informed, it's about getting involved. And I've heard that, so I'm focusing on Jesus. So I'm trying to, how can I get involved? When you focus on Him and you do what He's telling you to do, all of a sudden, freedom begins to happen in you. So you have to put your faith in God. You have to focus on God. But then you have to walk with God. How do you walk with God? Adam and Eve, and they experienced God walking with them in the garden. And I take some walks with God, and I believe that prayer is not just a monologue, but a dialogue. And if you don't think I'm crazy, I talk to God, but I think that He talks to me too. And there's this relationship that we have. But 1 John talks about walking with people. And if you walk with people, it's similar and almost synonymous with walking with God. He is in me, and if He's in you as a brother and sister, and we walk together, we're walking with each other, but we're also walking with Him. They call that fellowship. And whenever you walk with people, see, some people get bound up because they isolate themselves. They get bound up because they're all alone and they have no one to help them out. But when you walk with people, you hear encouraging stories, like I mentioned a moment ago, that's in the bulletin. You hear encouraging stories and you get strengthened, and all of a sudden you have this power to break free. So how do you get free? You put your faith in God. You put your focus on God. And you walk with God. If you're here tonight and you have never put your faith in God, this is the opportunity to do that. Sandy, if you'd come up, but please. This is a great opportunity. You don't want to procrastinate because you don't know what tomorrow brings. You don't know if a doctor will give you that scenario. You don't know what will take place. Faith in God is the beginning point. But I also feel like there are those here that you are walking with God. You are a quote-unquote Christian. And yet you've lost focus. Maybe you're going through a real difficult time, a real trying time, and you have lost sight, and God wants to help you regain your focus. And then I know that there are people in this service or in all the three services combined, those who, they really haven't been walking with God. They may have a conviction or a belief, but it's a head belief, but they haven't been walking with God. And this is a great season, a great day to say, God, I want to walk with You. I want to start walking again. I want us to sing this song together, and I want freedom to just happen in your lives. I want freedom to take place. And if you want to put your faith in God, just say, God, I recognize that I have a past and it's not all that glorious, and I need to be freed from that. Would You free me from my sin? Would You help me, oh God, to experience You in a new way? And you know God will do that. Just say verbally, Jesus, I put my faith in You. I believe in You now, and freedom can happen to you. Oh God, I've lost my focus, I've lost my sight. Would You open my eyes again so I can see You? I haven't been intentional. I know what I should do, but I haven't gotten around to do it. I want to be intentional. I'm getting back on track tonight. Or those who say, I haven't been walking with God. God, would You strengthen my legs? Would You get me back on track? Sing with me, My Chains Are Gone. Hallelujah, Lord. We praise Your name, Jesus.
Yeah.
Hallelujah, Lord. Hallelujah, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Even as they're still being broken, Lord, just set us free tonight, Father. Just acute teaching, Lord. Just singing a song doesn't do it. You're the one who sets free. But the very act that we've gone through tonight, I believe that you'll be faithful because you said that you have set yourself this weekend to set people free. And in the name of your Son, Jesus, I pronounce freedom to those who are in need of freedom. And whether we know it or not, Lord, we all stand before you in need of your help and your assistance. But you respond to those who cry out to you. And those who have put their faith in you tonight, I pray that you would hear their cry. Those who have lost their focus but is regaining that, I pray, oh God, that that would happen. And for those who are returning to walk with you, I pray that you'd strengthen them, oh Lord, even as you strengthened Peter who denied you. With your eyes closed and your heads bowed, is there anyone here who just raise your hand and say, tonight, I did put my faith in Jesus. You may have been even going to church, but you haven't done it for a long time, but you put your faith in Jesus. Yes, yes, yes. Putting your faith in Jesus tonight. You're starting a relationship with him. How many of you tonight, with you, if you'll just lower your hands, those of you who have your hands up, who of you have lost focus of him? You've been going through a real difficult time, a dark time, and you haven't been able to see him. But he's going to open your eyes this night. In Jesus' name, open the eyes of those who have their hands raised. And how many of you haven't walked with God, but you're returning tonight? You're saying, I want to start walking with the risen Lord tonight. Would you raise your hand? You haven't been walking with him, but you're returning tonight. You're returning tonight. Jesus, we thank you for speaking to us. We thank you for ministering to us. We thank you for calling us together so that we could celebrate. Remember your cross and celebrate your resurrection, because it was those two events that changed our history. And we are so and forever grateful to you. We give you praise. Would you stand with me? We're going to sing that song again. And if you raised your hand and you put your faith in Jesus for the first time, I would love to have you come down, because I would like to give you a Bible and I would like to give you a packet so that it can help you grow. If you came down and if you don't have a Bible tonight, would you please come down? There will be others that join me down here who can just give you this. We would love to have some sort of record that you're giving your life to the Lord so that we can begin to pray for you and begin to help you along the way. So let's sing this again, and you can make your way down as we conclude our service tonight.
And my chains are gone.
As we leave this place tonight, we want to say thank you for all that you've done for us. And I pray that everyone would experience freedom in, whether it be from yesterday's pain, freedom from tomorrow's uncertainties, or from today's pressures. I pray that freedom would be our mark, oh God, that we have touched you. We need no longer walk in shame, filled with guilt, because you've dealt with our resentment and our bitterness, and you've changed us and given us a brighter tomorrow. And we love you for that, and we give you praise. And everybody will say with me as we conclude, He is risen. He is risen. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you. Amen. God bless you tonight. Have a happy Easter.